Okay, so I'm Alan Edgar. I work in Queen's University. I've been there for 34 years, so I must be doing something right. Either that they can't figure out how to get rid of me. And I've seen a huge change during the years. We originally started making relatively, it's always been commercial work, I might add. I'm not an academic. And we originally started making relatively simple jigs and fixtures. And in those days, we really didn't worry too much about safety. We would just look at the specification that the customer wanted and we would build it for them. So it didn't really matter if you could put your finger in here and get it caught. We looked on that as, well, don't put your finger in there. And that was the attitude prior to CE marking. So the rest of the slides that I have here showed the response that we had to CE marking. And I'm not saying that's the only response, but it's from a personal point of view, this is the way that we went. So originally when the Machinery Directive came in 96, sounds like a long time ago. I remember it well, obviously. And it was a real sea change because you had the designer had to take responsibility for the safety of the machine in all its aspects. That doesn't sound so astounding to you, but it was a step change for us. And we thought initially, because previously we had been making machinery and saying, well, if you want, we can manufacture guards for you. It'll cost more. And without exception, every company said, no, don't worry about the guards, that's fine. We just want something nice and simple that fulfills the function. Whenever CE marking was coming in, we thought, well, we're going to go out of business here because the guards were starting to cost as much as the machines. And we realized that was because of the way that we were doing. We didn't design the guards whenever we started the design of the machine. And what we realized was, as soon as we were looking at the specification and the function for a machine, we would say, how are we going to guard it? We know there's certain hazards here, and we've got to guard it. Our response universally was, we basically put the guarding structure as part of the superstructure. It was built into the frame of the machine and opening doors and all that sort of thing. So this was for Canyon Europe, and that was to pack sprayers into a box. We actually achieved 20% more sprayers in a box, which enabled them to cut down on their transport costs. This was a company called Vistian in Dunmurry. It used to be Ford Autolite. And these three machines here were for continuous use. In other words, maybe two or three shift working, maybe over the weekend as well. And they were production line machines. They weren't just test equipment, it was actually on the production line. And obviously you had to take responsibility for if there was a fault, it had to be fixed and quickly. And it had to be very safe. So as you can see, locking doors or else fixed panels and much the same here. That was made for Kent Plastics. I'm sorry to say that we built these for the for a company which is still in around. Vistian and Kent Plastics, of course, have gone. Okay, so what I'll be talking about is what's the aim of CE marking? What does safe mean? Where do approvals come in? The procedure, which is, I've put sort of a common procedure across all the directives. What directives are, how they're enforced. Okay, so the aim. Well, wouldn't it be nice? Safe products, used in a safe way, that would all be fine, wouldn't it? I mean, that's really what we want. And of course, that would then enable you to market a machine right across the European Union. Well, it's not really as simple as that, because I have never once yet talked to a designer who deliberately sets out to make an unsafe machine. But I have examples of where unsafe products were put on the market. And it wasn't just a matter of someone's finger got hurt. This particular one, it's a local alert, HSENI, and it's about scissor lifts. And certain types of scissor lifts have to make daily safety checks. Five people have been killed in three accidents where they actually toppled. And of course, if you're working at height, falling is never going to be pleasant at all. So five people killed in 4 years. And that's one type of machine. Here we have another one. Now, this is the European system has a rapid alert system called RAPEX. Now, it tends to be more for consumer products, so it doesn't necessarily, it's not just for machines, it would tend to be for tools and that sort of thing. So, ladders are included. This one wasn't strong enough, doesn't comply with the European standard, and it was compulsory withdrawn from the market. We have an angle grinder. This is on a website, by the way. You can go and search it. It's pretty dismal reading, to be honest. For example, if it was to ask you, where do you think these products in the main that are withdrawn from the market, where do you think they've been manufactured? Like to guess? It's not...
Here.
Sorry?
Here?
No, no. Definitely not. No, we've got a pretty good safety record, in fact. So where do you think they were manufactured?
China,
yes. Now, that's not really surprising because you've got to remember China is the workshop of the world. But even so, they do have a tendency to copy products. And in some cases, they copy products that weren't compliant in the first place. And in some cases, they make a mess of copying something. So anyway, this angle grinder, I mean, we've all used angle grinders, but the guard was somewhat weak, probably fairly cheap metal, bent easily. And I mean, you know, if you've ever used an angle grinder, they're easy to drop. And in those circumstances, this particular one bent, probably hit the blade as well, and you could then actually touch the blade. So, doesn't comply with the machinery directive or the relevant standard, and it was compulsorily withdrawn from the market. Now, I have here probably what may well be a made-up picture, but I think it represents, well, I don't know what these guys are thinking, obviously, but it illustrates a point. There's three people here. I reckon they're all thinking different things. I would say this older guy, maybe he's the foreman. He's really work-focused. He's thinking about making sure that the workers aren't slacking. So he's got a list of things to do which must be done on that day. He's not in the least bit worried about all sorts of stuff lying around the floor. He just wants the work done. I would suggest that this youngster here, probably an apprentice, he's not wearing any, in fact, those are open-toed sandals on a building site. He's no head protection, no gloves on, and he's probably thinking to himself, so he hasn't a care in the world, apart from probably having to make tea for the workers. And he's looking at this older guy saying, why has he got that stuff on his head? And this person here, who obviously has some concerns about safety, otherwise he wouldn't have put that on his head. He's thinking, well, hold on, we used to use bamboo scaffolding. Now, if one of those falls on your foot, or if it even falls on your head, well, it's probably going to bounce. It's okay, it's going to hurt a bit, but it's not going to kill me. But he's just saying this new thing, steel scaffolding. If that falls on my head, that's going to be totally different. So that's not going to work anymore. And I have another few. Now, I don't know, I mean, is this a posed picture or not? Because it's just everything's wrong. So he's working in a swimming pool in the water, and obviously he didn't want to leave his boots on, you know, to get wet. So he's barefoot up a steel aluminium ladder, and he's working with a mains lead trailing across the place with a mains drill. I mean, there's so many things wrong here. I mean, you just, I could spend the rest of the day talking about this. But is it posed? I don't know. This one definitely isn't posed. It's bad enough, no harnesses in sight. Person here is holding on far too close, if you ask me, to the guy at the top. But hold on, there's no one in the digger. It's the digger driver who's gone up here. I mean, it's just, I mean, you know, instead of getting a longer ladder, he improvised. So obviously no risk assessment done there. And this I see quite frequently as I travel around the countryside, where there's a bit of electrical kit. It's old, gets a wee bit hot, but it still works, still does a job. But we'll give it a bit of a hand, so we'll leave a door open. That'll help, but that wasn't enough, you know, because occasionally we get a hot day. So we need a fan. So we get a fan that looks as though it's as old as this bit of kit here, probably 30 years old or something. And it's mains, so I mean, never mind. Oh, we'll just leave the lead trailing around the floor. What could go wrong? And we need to get it at the right height, so we'll just use the odd barrel. Hold on, there's a notice here. Does it say explosive, flammable, or what? You know, I mean, who knows? It's just, and I see this. I mean, you know, you can probably point to certain parts in your factory where you've maybe seen this. And it's because you want the work to go on, and you don't think to sort out these problems. They grow up, in other words. Right, so the CE mark is not to guarantee protection for consumers. I think the preceding slides and the RAPEX system illustrate that point. It would be nice if it did give protection, but it doesn't necessarily. It's not a quality mark. It's not optional. You've got to, if it comes under the scope of a directive, you must CE mark it. And it's not necessarily to make work for legislators, but boy, it certainly does. So what does it indicate? Well, the product complies with all the applicable European directives and the minimum requirements of the relevant European harmonized standards. Paul will be talking more about standards. So I won't go into detail on that particular one. So that's then a passport to allow the product to be traded within the European Economic Area, which is the European Union plus Norway, Iceland, Liechtenstein, and Turkey as well, believe it or not. They're not actually in the European Union, but they're applying the legislation for a prospective entry. So that gives something like 31 countries, 510 million population. No one knows what the population is. We don't know how many people are in the UK, so you can imagine. That's why I put plus. No one knows. So governmental agencies are limited to what is essential to ensure safety and fair trade. Reasonable sort of thing. The CE mark itself is not a recognised, it's not a type font. It's on a grid, specially designed, and in fact there's a committee sitting to talk about whether they should change this. They'll probably spend about a couple of million pounds, and they'll maybe, I mean, it's a bit, you know, that's the sort of thing that a child might draw up, you know, so they'll maybe round it or something. I'm sure they'll modify it in some way. Compliance must be demonstrated if challenged by the appropriate authorities. Right, well, none of you here are the appropriate authorities. I'll explain that later on, which you might have thought that you could, if you might have thought that if you bought something, that you could actually get a technical file which demonstrates compliance. No, you don't have that legal right, unless you put it as part of your purchase requirements. Must be indelibly fixed to the product. In other words, not a flimsy label which can fall off. But if it's too small, you can put it on the packaging or guarantee or in instructions. But it must be 5 millimeters high and of that shape. You can, in fact, in practice, you can put it on everything. Not only the product, the packaging, instructions, everything. That's the website to actually get it. Normally, CE marking is done by the manufacturer. That's the best person to do it. but and it's normally done by the company itself using internal production control. But it could be done by the importer if it's coming from outside Europe. I want to draw a distinct difference between approvals. There is no, they are totally different activities, in fact. Approvals, you'll have seen these, BAB with the kite mark, TUV, Paul works for, UL, there's the American one. They're all carried out by an independent authority. They assess and test to the appropriate standard, and obviously that would generally be to a higher standard than the manufacturer themselves will have done. Whenever you get an approval, the approval mark is a brand, a bit like Nike on shoes. The point is that the brand does carry a reputation with it, which CE marking doesn't. In most cases, that's the manufacturer's opinion that it conforms. So, and in fact, the way to wind Paul and me up is to talk about CE approval. There is no such thing as CE approval. It's CE certification. And it's done well by some companies, and it's done very badly by others, and by some not done at all. And I've got some slides about that too. So the general procedure, Paul will be talking at length about this, but just to give you the scope of it, assess your product, match to the scope of all applicable directives. We'll be doing more on that. They're free. You can get them from the Europa website, and you really should download them and read them. They look a bit intimidating, but in fact, you only probably need to read the first five or six pages. There's a lot of addendums to it. Self-certify using current EN standards. Standards are only usable if they're still current. However, I could do a whole seminar on standards, so I won't say anything more. And by the way, please free to ask questions. We do have plenty of breaks coming up, so if you don't want to put your hand up and shout a question out, that's fine. You can talk to either me or Paul in the breaks. Specify components that you know comply. And I underlined it. I should have put it in bright capitals, because so often when I ask people, why did you specify that component? You just know that they want to say, well, it was cheap. Or it's functional, it looks okay, the reputation of the manufacturer. But none of that is any good. You have to specify components that you know comply, not think that they comply. Assess whether and how to test. For electrical products, there must be a 100% production line test on everything. For the machinery directive, you evaluate the essential health and safety requirements. Slightly different, but still same thing, really. You have to have a technical file, and that'll contain declarations of conformity or declarations of incorporation, which is only for the machinery directive. It doesn't exist in any other directive. And test reports. You will notice this is number six, don't start by putting the CE mark on the product and saying, right, that's what we mean. We've just got to get the documentation right. No, it's number six on the list. It's near the end. No engineer likes doing the paperwork. I'm exactly the same. I've got loads of reports to do back home, back at base. But I would much prefer to stand up and talk to you about getting your paperwork right. So I do understand, but really you do need to get the paperwork right. You should sign the Declaration of Conformity, or for the Machinery Directive, Declaration of Incorporation. And unfortunately, you haven't finished. Now, somehow we went from six to five. I don't know. This happens every time. No matter how much I proofread these, I always spot something that I mix. So I put that in deliberately, guys, just to keep you on your feet. So you keep changing things. You know, you find you can't buy certain components from the same people that you did previously, or you improve it or something, but it's an ongoing thing. You need to go back to the CE marking and check that it's still relevant. Right, now, how do you find the right directive? Well, you've got plenty to choose from. Toy safety was the first one, obviously not an engineering type one. I mean, the rest are engineering. So this all kicked off in 1990. The ones that we're talking about today are machinery safety. It's came in 95 and was adjusted twice. Well, a brief word about electromagnetic compatibility. It's just being recast as we speak, and I don't even have a number for it yet, because they don't know, it hasn't been ratified yet. Low voltage directive, I touch on that later today. And again, this is not a misprint. It was actually enforced in 1974, but it wasn't part of CE marking. So the low voltage directive is one of the oldest directives that you could ever specify. But it again is coming up for a recasting like the EMC one. And there may be people here who want to talk about the pressure equipment directive. Hands up if there's anyone who wants to talk about the pressure equipment directive. Do you make tanks of any sort? No? You guys see me later. If you have wireless product, you know, it's quite common now to use wireless control on various things. Well, that'll come under the radio and telecom equipment directive. You may come under explosive atmospheres in your work, either because of dust or vapor. And restriction of hazardous substances is now part of the CE marking regime, and that specifies certain chemicals that you're not allowed to incorporate over a really small threshold amount in your products. Now, there's loads of non-CE marking ones. General Product Safety Directive applies to consumer products if there's no other directive applying. Batteries Directive, Noise Emission of Outdoor Equipment Directive, that'll apply to outdoor machinery. And waste electrical and electronic equipment, and I'm really not going to say much more about that. But if you do have a question on any of those, I can talk about it at length, but I don't want to bore the rest of you. Now, if you find yourself in court, it'll be the High Court, by the way, and the Northern Ireland legislation, which is normally used, overwhelmingly, it's going to be Health and Safety at Work, NI Order 1978. It's a very old order, but it's a well-trodden path. I haven't been able to trace any Northern Ireland company prosecuted under CE marking. But there are other ones, Noise at Work regulations, Electricity at Work, Provision and Use of Work Equipment regulations. Paul will be talking about PURE later on. Control of Substances Hazardous to Health. So all of those are ones that if you find yourself in court, they'll be quoting those ones. And how is it enforced in the UK? Well, trading standards for EMC, Health and Safety Executive for the Safety Directive, so that's for Machinery Safety and Low Voltage Directive, National Measurement Office for the Restriction of Hazardous Substances, Vehicle Certification Agency for Waste Electrical Equipment, and Environmental Health for Construction Products. Construction products came in, originally the UK had absented itself from the European Construction Products Directive, but when the construction products regulations came in, we're now included in that, and that's been a big change, in fact. So I can talk about that too if you need me to. Right. Okay, so they're powers. I mean, what I think I'd said, in general, the agencies don't want to close a manufacturing company down, and they adopt a light touch. So they'll always seek to inform and warn before they go to the next stage, which is prohibit the sale of the product. They can seize the product. They can require you to recall and fix it. And the last resort, if you end up in the magistrate's court, that's a £20,000, well, up to a £20,000 fine. And oops, 12 months imprisonment. Well, you see, now the company would pay the fine, wouldn't they? But you can't imprison a company. Who do you think would go to jail? In fact, it could go right back to the designer. It could be the engineer who built it. It could be the director of the company. And depending on the severity, it could be the whole lot of them. But the chances are that all of those mentioned people would appear in court and try to explain to a judge that they weren't the guilty party. If you end up in the High Court, that's an unlimited fine on the company and up to 2 years imprisonment. And this is all criminal stuff, by the way. You end up with a criminal record. As engineers, I know it's safety, but it seems to me that you could unknowingly commit an offence and end up with a criminal record. Something to think about. And it's good that you've come here, but hopefully that underlines that what Paul and I will be talking about, you do need to pay attention to it. So, looking at Great Britain workplace fatal injuries, you can see that manufacturing isn't the worst. Total fatals are 5, but that was only in a quarter. Last year, in fact, there were 20 people killed in manufacturing. That was 20 people who went to work and didn't come home again. And I have now, in the notes, I have a load of prosecutions. This is the only one that I could find under CE marking. So this was supply of machinery, safety regulations. No attempt to get CE marking, doesn't meet health and safety requirements. A fairly small fine. You'll see, if you hopefully look at your notes, that the fines will be climbing. £3,000 is probably about the minimum. This one here, they were fined. They had an unguarded chain drive, really dangerous things. The machine was CE marked, and there'd been no accident. But the fact that there's no accident doesn't confer any immunity from prosecution. Here's another one. London company fined £18,000 with over £9,000 costs. Again, health and safety, that's the usual one that they get done for. Agency worker lost the tips of 4 fingers. Right, now, what you find in these notices from the HSE, they have been becoming more descriptive about where they found the problems. So, there was a risk assessment, but it wasn't a sufficient risk assessment. I mean, I've heard people say, oh, risk assessment, that's dead easy. Sure, you can rhyme it off, don't even need to write it down. I'll remember it when I go to court. Well, I would say to you, if you haven't written it down, it's not sufficient. And even if you have written it down, is it correct? So don't think that you will get away if the HSE's opinion is that someone has been hurt and your risk assessment hasn't covered that particular factor, then it's not sufficient. Didn't give the operator adequate instruction. I'm not even sure what adequate instruction is, but it'll probably be something like written notes, a training program, written signing off that they've had the instruction, and retraining, periodic refreshers, because otherwise it's not adequate. And again, we get adequate for safety checks. So if you look at the totality of that, you can sort of see that not being, if you try to do a slap happy job, you may end up in court explaining to the judge why you did that. Another one, again, I'm not going to go through the entire thing, but the point again is no documented safe system of work, and the operative had not received any formal information, instruction, or training. The point is, if it's not written, how can you prove that it happened? So your documentation has to be pretty good here. And the point is, if you can remember when you did exams, maybe some of you are still doing exams, you're young enough to be doing that. What do you do whenever you are going to revise? You look at the old papers, don't you? You look at what's gone ahead and you sort of, you know, get a feel for what you've got to answer and the level that you have to hit. Well, again, the HSE prosecutions tell you what you have to do. So past history is very important here. And it's getting harder and harder. I mean, this is a relatively recent one. And not only are they getting more picky and more descriptive, but the fines are going up as well. This is one, and I've seen this, guards being taken off. I've been in a factory where, in fact, the very main sockets were hanging off the wall. I mean, that's always a bad sign to start off with. And that continued through the factory. There was a new machine, a saw, a rotary saw, huge blade on it. There was no guard on it. And I said, oh, I'm surprised to see this machine here. It looks new. It is new. But there's no guard on the blade. He says, no, we took it off. Right. Well, I wasn't there for that particular purpose. But the point is, having an unguarded machine of any sort is you don't even have to have an accident on it to be prosecuted. And management had failed to stop this highly dangerous practice. We all know that technicians can take shortcuts, and it's to get the job done, get the production line moving, that sort of thing. If management has failed to stop whatever it is they're doing, management is responsible. Difficult enough to do, actually. This is an local prosecution. Local company fined £5,000. The fines in Northern Ireland are about a tenth of what you would pay in HSE in England. And in fact, in England, if the HSE inspector comes out, you pay him, is it £194 an hour? Something like that. And that includes when he writes the report saying what you didn't do right. We haven't got to that stage here yet, thankfully. This unfortunate employee had been trapped by an unguarded, again, you know, this keeps on happening. And second one, this involved corporate manslaughter, in fact. And local company fined £100,000, a lot more cost because, again, barristers were involved. Safety panels had been removed. Well, again, you know, guards taken away. So that they could add raw ingredients more easily. Doesn't sound good, doesn't it? You know, I mean, can you imagine going to court saying, well, it was easier for us. But it wasn't easy for the poor person who got killed, you know? I mean, you wouldn't give that sort of reply to, a school child wouldn't give that sort of reply to the headmaster, you know? So safety panels had been removed, and it had been like that for 3 years. Now, if I had a pound for every time I was told when I spotted something, but it's been like that from the start. We've been here for 25 years. Well, that's good. They've been lucky for 25 years. But the point is, if it doesn't comply, whether there's an accident or not, you can still be prosecuted.